Welcome to another edition of the Rangman Show. Today we have Tamanna Punjabi and obviously my compatriot in this crime, Keyur. So Tamanna is a cancer conqueror and she lives a life by this word called as positivity. Positivity in profession, positivity to conquer any ailment in life, and positivity to rise in academics. She's right now studying with ISP. Or rather at ISP Hyderabad, which is one of the most reputed B schools in the country. Keyur and I have never been to a B school, so we anyways find this like too good. And the bigger thing is that Tamanna has successfully conquered cancer, which is like phenomenal. And after cancer, the word that she actually spreads to people is humility. So hats off to her. Welcome, Tamanna.
Before you see anything, what an introduction! Oh my God, I'm very embarrassed, but thank you.
तुम्हारी आज तमन्ना पूरी हो गई ना, तुम रंगमंच छुपे आ गए.
Yeah, बस. This was my life goal. I've reached, arrived.
So Tamanna, just walk us through your journey, because I remember that we used to work together at Soho Square, which was like, I don't know, 15 years back when I was a baby.
Oh my God, I'm not that old at all.
And you weren't.
No, but he is no.
So,
yeah, but then if you're working together,
from Soho Square to celebrity management to being a cancer conqueror and now to be studying in one of the leading B schools in the country is quite a journey. So just walk us through that.
Yeah.
Sure. So, thank you for having me. And okay, so I'll start about how I got to know Keyur. We were interning together at Soho Square many years ago, but not as many as you said.
And you realize what a mistake you made.
So we were no, oh my God, I wouldn't be here if I didn't know him. So hello. At all.
Keyur has done something right.
No, so we used to have a lot of fun. We'd go like all our breaks and stuff would be together at Soho Square.
Yeah.
We would skip lunch and all, we'd go together. So I got to know him then. And then, so I was interning at that time during my undergrad with Soho Square, after which then I graduated in media and communication, and I had specialized in public relations. So I started working with this small startup called Thinking Communications in Bombay, which does PR for entertainment clients. So including celebrities, films, and a lot of content brands and stuff. So I was handling the PR for them, all the image management and all of that. So I was doing that, and it was very, very fun, extremely glamorous job, because you get to go to like award functions and all these things that you before that thought happened only on TV. And so I used to do that, after which I was doing that for 5 years. After three, I quit, and I was freelancing as a content writer and a PR consultant. So when I'd headed back home in 2019, I headed back home from Bombay. And then I was working from home. I got admission into ISB that year. And then I got cancer. So then I was like, okay, I have to possibly defer it. So I got non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, which is also what Pranay had. So we somehow bonded on something really dark, but also really
viewers, we've bonded not on cancer, but on humility. That's what
the surviving of it. Yeah. And also the fact that the amount of drive you have to do all these things, I think it's commendable and it's beautiful. So so I also had non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and I did not want to defer college. I still wanted to go in 2020. So, and the doctor had told me that you will be fine by March, and college was starting in April.
So you were diagnosed in 2019, Tamanna?
Yes, 2019, October. Yeah.
So
and
what were the early symptoms? As how did you get to know that something was wrong?
So I'm a fairly fit person, and I've always been interested in, you know, like exercising, eating right and all. So I didn't even realize I used to go to the gym, and I started having chest pain one day. And I figured that I'd done something extra maybe yesterday. And so I'm having like chest pain. Then I came home and I was still having it. It kept increasing. And because we live in Indian setting, hamara pehla thought tha ki wo indigestion ho rahi hai. Gas ho rahi hai. Pata nahi kya kya we were thinking. Digeen kha lo. Pata nahi kya kya we were doing. And then it did not reduce. So then we head to the doctor, and the doctor gave me some, they did a few tests, and the doctor said, you have some inflammation in your lung ka walls. So you'll need like 2 weeks to get better. These are your medicines. So I took those medicines and everything was fine. And I figured everything is fine. And then 2 weeks later, again, on I think October 1st or something, I started having immense pain in my chest again. It wasn't as bad as the first time, but it was there. And so I was like, matlab, I'm really like, I'm 24, for goodness sake, I shouldn't be having all these pains at that age. And my mom was at work, so was my sister. So I was alone at home. And then I decided that I just need to go and get like a full body checkup done and figure what is wrong. So I drove myself to the hospital and I called my mom's friend and I said, I'm coming. Can we just do a few tests and stuff? Because this is happening again within a month. So then she started doing all these tests, and that was the early symptom. And then that's how we kind of discovered that there is something wrong.
So when you were diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, which stage was it?
End of stage one and starting of stage two, something like that.
So it was localized?
Yeah, localized. Thankfully, yeah, localized.
So when you did get to know that it's non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, what was your first reaction?
I have to tell you, this is really funny. So first of all, I'm sure you'll relate to this. As humans, we are so adaptable. First, the thought of cancer is shocking. Then the next thing is, okay, now you've made peace with that. So the next thing is, it shouldn't be like more than localized. It should be localized. So the moment the doctor said localized, I was actually relieved. And I was like, oh my God, look at how fast we adapt. Like, you know, 5 seconds back, we didn't even born cancer. And now we're like, okay, theek hai, idhar hi hai na, theek hai. So, my mom got to know a few days before me, and she of course was very like shaken. She cried and away from me. I did not know. And, so she was in a bad state, but so I was having a lot of tests, and in those tests, they recommended me to go to a cancer hospital. So somewhere in my head, I kind of had an idea. Okay. Because otherwise, why am I going to a cancer hospital, a specialty one? So, I had a 50-50% chance in my head.
This was in Bombay or some other city?
No, Vishakhapatnam. I was at home Vishakhapatnam. My family lives there. So we went to this, we kept going to this hospital for different tests. And then the day the doctor told me, my mom and I were sitting and he told her that he's going to tell me. So like, you know, she should be prepared to like handle any outburst or whatever. And so we're sitting there and the doctor's like, okay, so you have lymphoma. I said, okay. And then he's saying it's lymphatic cancer. I said, okay. And how long will it take to heal? And he said, 6 months. And then he's waiting. He's giving me like 10 seconds to start crying or like do something, like react. And I'm like, okay, like tell me the solution. Because in my head, I was like, matlab, main aa rahi hoon itne din se, toh chance toh tha na. So it wasn't like a extreme
surprise.
Yeah, like, you know, the actual shocker, I would say, was when they told me ki biopsy karni hai, and I had no idea ki biopsy hoti kya hai. So when they said that, I went home and I first Googled biopsy. I was like, what does it mean? And then it said that it's a test that tells you whether you have cancer or not. So that was I think, a shocker.
Check whether the tumor is benign or malignant. That you have it.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So that was more a shocker, honestly. When the doctor said, I was just looking at him, I was like, okay, so in 6 months, I'll be fine. And he said, yeah. I said, because I have to go to college and I'll be able to go. He said, yeah, of course you'll be able to go. I said, okay, great. So then we just moved ahead and I asked him, what are my symptoms? He said, you can come back with questions. with whatever questions you have. And I actually like wrote down a list of 15 questions. Can I eat this? Can I drink this? Will my hair fall? What are the, I had so many questions. He went there and he said, this is the first time I have a patient who has come with such a prepared list of what you want to ask me. So yeah, I wasn't really sure.
As much as I like Jim Carrey, the Riddler, no, he would have shied away with the amount of questions you had.
I really did. I was shocked he didn't yell at me, because I was like, I went with a book and a paper and a pen, and I figured he's going to be like, you think I have no other work? But
no, you've been in the B-school zone since 2019 only then.
Forever. I'm a very question asking person.
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah.
So your journey was basically from the hospital to the B-school.
Yeah. Oh my God. You know, I had my second round interview after he told me that I had cancer. And so I was like, oh my God, now can I not go for my interview? And my mother was like, are you mad? Like, what is your priority? What are you thinking? And so I asked the doctor, I said, can I go for my interview? It's in Hyderabad. And so chemo was supposed to start on 20th of October. I made him push it to 21st because 20th was my interview. So I came to Hyderabad, I gave my interview, and then went back and started chemo.
You know, but Tamanna, it's quite commendable that your determination to get through to ISP didn't suffer even an iota of a dent when you were diagnosed with cancer, which is like phenomenal, yeah, because it just shows that if you have the will to succeed, you can never fail. So that's something
I think that's really nice of you, but I also think it's just I think we get the struggle that we can handle. Like, I really believe that everybody gets as much struggle as they can handle. So if I can lift 100 kgs, then I lift 100 kgs, right? So
your will comes out of the fact in how do you want to go through that struggle and how stronger do you want to come out of that struggle. And that's why precisely Kayur and I, like, we salute you as the women of will on this channel today.
Yeah, because I remember...
Thank you so much. Yeah,
because I remember I think a week or two back when we were having a conversation, Pranay and I. And Pranay was like, "Aur kuch ideas hai, kya kya kar sakte hai na?" And he suggested that he wants to do something on the same lines again, women of will ke upar, he wants to do something. So I was like, can we talk to actual people instead of talking about some really famous people or something like that? And then I know the line that he goes by: if success is the only option, then you can't fail. And I have been following you on Instagram since.
Please do. So Tamanna, Tamanna and viewers, if you have the will to succeed, failing can never be an option.
Failing can never be an option. And I really like that line. And I've been following Tamanna on Instagram since a long time. And I have, like, most of her journey I have seen on Instagram. And that was literally the first thing that came to my mind, that who is somebody whose story I personally would like to listen from herself. And not just because it's a really amazing story, but also because it's somebody that I know of and somebody that I have worked with and somebody who's really my age. And kind of inspires me to an extent, like I've said earlier on the earlier episodes as well, that I try to find inspiration in really small things and everyday kind of things. And what's more everyday than somebody that you know, somebody you've worked with? It's been really inspiring. If you go on her Instagram also, it's real, it's true. If you go on her Instagram as well, it's the stories that she puts up every day. Like, I didn't even know for the longest time that she was going through cancer. And it's just amazing. It's just amazing.
No, but, you know, I must say at this point that, you know, I think we as a society have made cancer such a taboo word. And I think, Pranay, you'll agree with that, because people don't want to talk about it. They don't want to say the word. They'll be like, oh my God, you're suffering with that. Hey, what is this that? Like, if I have a cold, you're not going to say, no, you're suffering with that. You'll say, I have a cold, or I have a fever, or I have dengue, or whatever. So why can't you say the word cancer? Like, I don't get it. So I used to, when I started putting it, that's why I started writing a blog. And the first thought that my family and my friends were like, no, don't put it out there. If you put it out there, people will know. I was like, yeah, that's the point. People should know that it's okay. Like, you know, whatever I'm going through, and if you're going through it, or even like a fraction of it, and you can relate, it's something, right? And even if not that, the fact is that 10, 15, 20 years down the line, I want to be able to go back to that and read it and be like, okay, if I got through that, I can get through anything else. So, I mean, it's a thing to read. Why should you not put it out at all?
You know, Tamanna, my understanding and my realization of the journey was that if you see cancer as a social stigma, na, you're going to get into more of a negative mindset. As you rightly said, that if you take this as one challenge you've overcome, possibly one of the biggest challenges that you'll ever face in life, then other problems will seem relatively smaller.
Way smaller, and, for sure. Yeah, there's nothing
that's the way it should be.
As much as that.
And I'm glad that you've put your story on Instagram, and you can put it on other platforms also, because the more people get to know that there's a person who's fought cancer and now she's doing so well academically to build a good career, it'll just motivate them. Because, you know, when I had cancer, the first thing that I thought was that, is my life going to be same again? I was in a decent job, earning decent salary. So the thing was that, am I ever going to get out of it to get back into my routine life? And in 6 months, I did. And in fact, it's funny that I coined a model when I just got out of cancer, when I started working with this NGO, called as the DDAD model. So when I got cancer, I was in denial. Then when I understood what I'd got, then I was dejected. Then when I went to the hospital, I accepted it. And the last D was the decision to fight it. So that's the DDAD model that I'd done. So I actually presented that to my NGO, and they take that as something that they sort of share with other people, with other patients, so that they have an inspiration or they have a understanding of how well they can conquer it. Yeah, so that was decent.
But this is the inspiration. I mean, listening to it is inspiring me. I'm thinking, wow, what a nice way to put it. And like, you've made it like a thing now. So it's easier to watch it or hear it, or, you know. It's very cool.
So tell me, when you had this disease, were you scared of the physical side effects, or was it more of a mental pressure that you were facing, or you didn't face any pressure altogether and you were just focused, I have to get into ISP?
No, aisa to no pressure to ho hi nahi sakta. I'm human. I was going through a whole lot of emotions and emotional turmoil in life. I don't think that's how it is. I don't think anybody who's going through cancer can ever go through less pressure, because at some point you're questioning everything, and you know, like, it's just the smaller things. On certain days you have good days and you're like, don't worry, I'll fight through this, I'll be like good, and you know, I'll be here in 10 years and all of that. And on certain days you're like, oh my god, am I even going to get through today? Because like, you know, you're going through such a wildly crazy time because of the amount of pains you're having. Like, I can't even explain. There were days when I would have pain like in my nose bone or in my chin. And I'm like, I didn't even know these bones can have pain. Like, you know, because when ever in your life are you going to have pain in your chin? Like, for goodness sake, I've not played anything. It's not like I got punched. And I'm suffering for 2 days with pain in this bone, in this bone. And it was just, like, you know, it was just so random. So some days it used to be like, oh my god, am I going to like get through today without any pain? And then on some days you've just gotten through the day and got done like 15 things. And so I didn't quit working. I continued to write, working with this agency as a content writer. And of course, like, a huge credit to them, because they were very supportive of the fact that they didn't treat me any differently. I had told them that I need to take 2 days off every 3 weeks for chemo and the day after chemo. And they were like, okay. I said, you can cut my pay for those 2 days every month. That's cool. If you guys are okay for me to continue working. Of course, there'll be days when I may not have the kind of energy to do 6 articles in a day, and I'll let you know. But then, I mean, if that works with you, let's continue. And they were very supportive. So they said, yeah, absolutely. And so I continued working. So that was a big kind of motivator also, distractor also, because it was not like I was sitting there and sulking. Oh my God, now I have cancer. You know, that's the thing. Like a lot of my family members were like, "Arey, you shouldn't work. You should sit and just like." I was like, "And do what? Like, what do I do all day? The day I have chemo, I have that. But all the other 3 weeks ke days, I'm just going to sit there and sulk. It doesn't make any sense." So, yeah, I mean, I think it depends on you, how you choose to fight it. Like you said, this DDHD, I think it's a process. DDAD, yeah. I think it's a process.
So instead of sulk, you became the Hulk, Tamanna. Mark Ruffalo. You decided to do more in life.
Yeah, no, but it's very necessary. I mean, I feel like the more you sulk about anything and not just cancer, if you sulk, it's going to continue. If you stop sulking and you get to it, it's going to go away. So, yeah.
So now on a more positive note, when you beat cancer, I mean, the last day when you were like, all this is done, how did you feel then?
Oh my God, I cut like 3 cakes. I was so excited. I cannot even put it in words. I wanted to like jump. I told everyone in my friends and family that tomorrow is the last radiation. I'm going to be free. And so like my friend from Pune sent me a cake. My uncle got a cake home and I was like cutting cakes and making momos and doing all sorts of things because I was very excited. I was like, okay, I'm finally done with this nonsense. It went on for 8 months and I was told 6 months. So I felt a little cheated for 2 extra months, but yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Celebration.
So when you got into ISP, did you share your story with your friends and all? And if you did, how did they react? I mean, the question stems from the fact that if you've shared your story, I've got very different reactions from people. So I want to understand how your reaction.
Tell me your reactions first. Just out of
curiosity. So it depends. I mean, people who understand what you've gone through in terms of who've seen your journey, they obviously like they support you and they know that it's best to make life as much in a normal sense as possible. And for people that you meet, like if you're meeting them for the first time or if you haven't met them through your journey, there is a concern. And for some people, it's like your routine life can never come back. They're like, oh my God, you've been through cancer. So is it going to be that what you were earlier, can that like ever return in terms of your pre-cancer days of enjoyment or the way you lived your life? So that I find a little funny, but the first were pretty okay. Because people don't know. People don't know what you've been through. So they don't know that cancer kitna detrimental ho sakta hai. And I don't blame certain people because as you said that the taboo or the social stigma of the C word is so high that it's like some people think that
it's not spoken about enough.
Yeah, it's the end of the world for you.
Yeah, for sure. And I honestly also feel like it did change me and I don't ever want to be that person who I was before. Like even if I was given that choice, not that I have it, but if I did, that would you want to be who you were before cancer? No.
Right.
I think I'm way more grateful than I ever was because I didn't take simple things like walking seriously. Like, you know, I didn't look at it like, oh my God, I'm grateful for this. It was just okay, it's part of my life. And then because of this disease, I realized that, oh my God, walking to the washroom on my own is something to be grateful for. Or like picking up a glass of water and drinking of my own is something to be grateful for. I'd like to be that way forever. So, yeah, I mean, it has changed me, but I'm happy it has.
I've seen 3 parts of your life. From the Hulk, you became Spider-Man because you're jumping with joy. After you beat cancer. And then from there, you became Johnny Walker, keep walking, because you realize the importance of walking in life.
Oh, my God.
Cancer brought 3 characters which you never knew existed.
Never knew. It's true. No, but very fun. Like, I like how you are doing this.
From a confidence perspective, did you feel that your confidence got, I'm sure it got dented, but what was the severity in terms of did you feel very low on confidence? So this is a two-part question. When you were fighting the disease and after that, when you started interacting with people on a day-to-day basis?
So when I was fighting the disease, honestly, initially, I think it hit more. And then it took a lot of working to get to a little bit better. What happened was that, so I was very proud of my long hair and I had waist length hair. And I had waited very, very long to kind of let it grow to that length because I was like, I want this long hair. And then when he said, your hair is going to fall off, my heart broke. I was like, oh my God. So now this has to restart the whole process. And so one day before my first chemo, I went and I got my hair chopped to this length. I was like, I can't see my hair fall from that length. So I'm just going to cut it off. And then I'm not attached to this length. So if it falls, it's not going to hurt as badly. So the confidence kind of hit a little bit was when, you know, the whole hair fell off and the skin kind of darkened and your just face looks very different. You look very sick, right? All the time. And so sometimes it hits you because it's not every day, but sometimes it does when you suddenly look at yourself in the mirror. And you're like, oh my God, is this how I look? Like, you know, so on those days, the confidence a little bit was shaken. But I'm a very defensive. If you tell me that, oh my God, you're looking this way, my instant response will be like, you know, mind your own business, because that's just who I am. So every time, so then I kind of got used to it and I realized that, okay, I'm going to go out and I'm going to go out bald. Because somebody told me that, you know, you should wear a wig. And I said, no, I cannot convince myself to be that way. Those who can should do it, but I'm not going to do it to satisfy your eyes. If I feel better about it, I'll do it. And I did. I felt it was not going with my personality. So I was like, I will go out bald. If you have a problem, look away. Don't look at me. No? So, and so I did. Like, I would go out completely bald. And of course, because women and like, oh my God, bald. Oh, you poor thing, cancer. This was the reaction for a bit. So it takes a bit for confidence to adjust. But after a point, I was very indifferent. I was like, okay, I'll just go for dinner also. And
did you experience sexist bashing also because of this disease?
Not so much. Honestly, there were a few like family friends and all who would say really like random things like, oh my God, it's umar mein ho gaya hai, abhi ladka kaise milega type something. And I, matlab, my mom is very chill. She doesn't care for all these things. So she would just tell me, you let it go. And I would tell her, I don't want to see this person till I get cured, please. So she would make sure that I don't. So that way, I mean, I don't think I would have been able to do it if my mom wasn't the way she is. So, yeah. You know, not so much sexist,
yeah,
but generally.
Hats off to her also. Yeah.
Exactly.
Hats off to her also. From the story that, whatever you've told up until this point, big hats off to her also. Like, seriously.
It's not easy for a parent to see like a young child go through this and, I mean,
and
so
still motivate you and tell
tough,
you that
then,
the world can like really take a backseat. That's very good.
Yeah. So, and she's a very strong person. So we both were very chill, like literally we were supposed to get our result on whether this is cancer or not tomorrow, for example. Today, we went out for a drink. We were like, before we get to know the reality of it, let's go celebrate. So we went out, we had a drink and we came back. We were like, okay, now we'll deal with tomorrow. So aisa matlab, she's very chill, very strong. So
did you, I mean, at least I've had this learning after cancer that like tomorrow ka jo bhi hoega, wo tomorrow can wait. You should live life now. What's now is the present, and that's actually a present. So does do you also feel that way?
Of course, every single day, like I was telling you, there are days when I'm just walking back from the campus to where I stay in the student village. And it's just a very beautiful campus. And I'm just walking back and I'm like, oh my God, wow. How am I here? Like, I'm actually living this, you know, because till last year, I didn't even know if I would be living or not. And suddenly I'm like living at this wonderful campus, which is like a resort. So I'm walking by and I'm like, wow, this is so beautiful. I'm very lucky. And so I cannot tell people this all the time because they'll think I'm crazy. But in my head, I keep saying thank you many times because I'm like, okay, I got through one more day of this beauty. So yeah, of course. I think that is one thing that any cancer survivor will say, anybody, that you just take every day so much more seriously and happily.
Pranay, I have this question for you, and Tamanna, yeah, you also can chime
guys,
in.
Guys, we have 9 minutes you remaining, just... because pre-cancer also had no money, post-cancer also have no money.
Yeah, I've been telling you, you have too many first world problems, yaar.
At least we are first somewhere, no?
Yeah.
Go on.
You practice that line, I know that.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I have a question. So what you just said about something, sometimes tomorrow can wait. But the field that we have worked in, like Tamanna also and Pranay also for that matter, how does that play into tomorrow can also wait? Like when you are in that state of mind where you have reached a place and you really want to stay in the moment and not it would be incorrect to say not care about tomorrow, but just focus more on what is there in your plate right now, and tomorrow can be dealt with when it comes. But the field that we worked in, it really becomes difficult to do that. So how did Pranay, because you, after you went through your ordeal of cancer, you were working, you were back to work, and you have been through that entire thing of tomorrow nahi, humko to kal chahiye tha sab. So how did you deal with that? Because the mindset of a person can be completely different. And how do you cope up with that? How do you do it?
You know, there's a term that I coined for people who kept bothering me, who didn't understand what my thought process was post-cancer, which is called as IP. It basically means intellectually bankrupt. So,
oh, so you used to call me IB when I was your junior.
At times, yeah. Whenever you bothered me. So the thing is that there are two aspects to it. One is that you should see what you can do about that at that point in time, which I wasn't doing so well. So I took a long-term decision, which is also two words, quit advertising. And believe you me, I'm in a happier space right now because I can manage my own work. I manage my own time. And every day when I go to sleep, I know I've accomplished something. I've published some nice work and it's quite satisfying. Tomorrow, I will see what I have to do. Whereas you're right in advertising, I mean, you never get that good night of sleep because you're constantly thinking, kal kitna bura hone wala hai. Agar aaj bura hua hai, toh kal usse zyada bura hai. It's not like kal kuch achha hone wala hai. So I totally get that, but just quit advertising, man. I realized that in 2 years and I've done that. So, the rest is your call.
Ruko, mujhe time hai.
No, I was also in the same industry and I mean, similar.
Yeah, that's why. Also, yeah.
But you know, I went this February for a channel launch, 6 days, 6 cities. We launched a TV channel. And of course, it's an insanely hectic thing to do. But I think perspective changes so much because in your head, you're like, this is not as important as my life. So I'm going to sit down and eat my dinner. Screw you. Like, you know, yes. Wait. Like,
That's actually a very valid point. Your priorities totally change, man.
Yeah, my priorities are totally different.
Yeah, you know what is important to you and what if it doesn't happen also at this very moment, you will still breathe your next breath.
Yeah, yeah. And because, so like before I got cancer and I was in PR, we were constantly in this stress ki, oh my God, sab abhi karna hai. Abhi hi karna hai. और मतलब आप लंच 5 बजे कर लोगे लेकिन आप बाकी सब अभी कर रहे हैं डिनर आप रात के 12 बजे कर रहे हो बिकॉज काम अभी कर नहीं यार नहीं मतलब लाइफ में माय प्रायोरिटीज हैव चेंज्ड सो आई एम लाइक नो नाउ हैव टू एक्सरसाइज मतलब आई हैव टू एक्सरसाइज इफ यू हैव टू वेट फॉर 1 आवर यू हैव टू वेट फॉर 1 आवर इफ आई हैव टू ईट माय मील एट 2 o'clock योर प्रेस रिलीज कैन वेट फॉर 1 आवर टिल आई फिनिश ईटिंग सो दीज आर थिंग्स दैट यू नो दिस इज प्रायोरिटी चेंजिंग आई थिंक इट्स माय परसेप्शन दैट हैज चेंज्ड बिकॉज आई एम लाइक इतना मरोगे नहीं एक घंटा लेट मिलेगा तो कुछ नहीं होगा जस्ट सिट डाउन लाइक इट्स ओके एंड सो आई हैव अ देन आई स्टार्टेड फाइटिंग बैक क्लाइंट बोलेगा 2 बजे चाहिए नहीं मैं 4 बजे दूं क्योंकि मुझे खाना खाना है 2 बजे इट्स जस्ट अ थिंग लाइक इट चेंज्ड विद दैट सो या
यू वुड ऑनेस्टली टू हैव द विल टू फाइट यू रियली डोंट नीड टू गो थ्रू द ऑर्डियल ऑफ कैंसर जस्ट स्टार्ट फाइटिंग एंड पुशिंग इट बैक
वो तो यू नो वी फाइट
या नो बट
इट्स अ वेरी सिंपल थिंग गाइस आई मीन सुपरमैन में भी मैन वर्ड तो आता है ना, एंड एवरी मैन हैज हिज चैलेंजेस. अगर मैन नहीं होना चाहिए तो वो सुपर गॉड होना चाहिए ना. सो आई मीन
इट्स दैट लर्न टू नो टू draw the line. Yeah. The problem
exactly.
This industry, I feel many times, is if you're taught that everything needs to be done now, I'm sorry, no. And so that remembering to draw that line and remembering that, okay, I need to have minimum amount of sleep, minimum amount of food, walk, whatever, I'm going to do it and look after myself, because kal main bimar pad gayi to ye bhi nahi hoga.
Exactly.
Jo abhi ho raha hai. So shanti se karo. So you know, this is a line we just have to learn to draw. Like, it's just mental break is necessary. Dekhungi main friends aadha ghanta yaar. Theek hai. Meri marzi.
So, Tamanna, we are almost running out of time. We have about 3 minutes 40 seconds. So, I want you to give the viewers and us some nice motivational words to end this podcast.
Thank you very
and
much.
And don't give me that expression that I put you in a spot, because I'm sure you can do a very good job of it.
No, I'm thinking what to say. So one thing that I've really learned, and I feel like everyone should just know this, is just be grateful for like every little thing. You're able to fill water, to drink it, to write, like your legs are working, you're waking up in the morning, you're fine. You're able to eat, you're able to cook. These are things to be grateful for. It seems silly, it seems too trivial, but it's not. It's when these things are taken away from you, then you realize that, oh my God. So just be grateful anyway for them. And also, nothing is more important than your health. Nothing ever, ever in this whole wide world, nothing is more important than your health. So whoever is telling you otherwise, just screw them. And just move ahead. Like, be like, my life is my health, and so I'm going to look after that first.
You know, picking from a word grateful.
I don't have anything else.
Yeah, picking on the word grateful, for KU's sake, I hope his clients also sometimes show that gratitude towards him for the amount of work he does. So KU, do you want to say anything?
No, but if they don't, you can just... say, I'm thankful for having you as a client, but I need my food, buddy.
Yeah, you can just basically say that. Go F yourself. That's fine.
Yeah, basically that. In a nicer way.
Yeah, basically that. In a nicer way, yeah. Yeah. You know Pia better than us, no? So.
Communicate it effectively.
Yes.
So, Tamanna here has communicated effectively in this podcast. She's conquered cancer effectively. She's doing a more than effective job by being at ISP. So we wish her all the best. This was another Women of Will on the Rangman show. Did we bring you another person, another warrior, another person who's making a difference in his or her life? This is Tamanna, Kevin, and me signing off. Cheers, guys.
Thank you so much.
Cheers.
Thank you so much for doing this.
Thanks, Tamanna. You're a rock star.
Are yeah, as are you for doing this. And Keyur to anyways a rockstar. He knows this.
I doubt that, but cheers.
No, lovely. That's so much fun. Thank you so much.